Good morning, everyone. Happy ECQ Sunday. So praise the Lord for this opportunity that we are still able to worship God even online. And thank the Lord for this opportunity to hear His word. And let us come to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we commit to you our day-to-day. As we hear your word, open our eyes, open our understanding to see your precious word and to embrace the truth of Christ. Enable us, O God, to apply it in our lives. Lord, we glorify you, we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we are still in our series, Anchored in Christ. And we are studying the book of Hebrews. Yes, indeed, one of the most challenging books that I ever studied as well, this book of Hebrews, because this is quite difficult because you need to dig to the Old Testament, to the setting and even the culture of the Jewish people. And let me remind you that the book of Hebrews was written to Jewish Christian who are experiencing persecution, experiencing pain, trials in their life, and most of them are doubting, perhaps afraid, or even worried about their life, about their future, because during that time, persecution is really rampant, and they don't know whether they would live 1 week from now, silang life. So they are facing difficult times. And this is also relatable to us because as Christians, we are also facing difficult times. We are in the pandemic and we are experiencing catastrophes, naturally, no, natural catastrophes, and even economic and other areas in our lives. So this book of Hebrews is really for us as well. And let us now begin to read the passage that we are about to study this morning. We are now in Hebrews chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. It says, "Therefore, holy brothers and sisters, partakers of heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Jesus. He was faithful to him who appointed him, as Moses also was in all his house. For he has been counted worthy more glory than Moses, by just so much as the builder of the house has more honor than the house. For every house is built by someone, but the builder of all things is God. Now Moses was faithful in all God's house as a servant, for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken later. But Christ was faithful as a son over his house, whose house we are, if we hold firmly to our confidence and boast of our hope." Now, before going to the message, let me ask you this question. What is the most important decision in your life that you really took time to consider? What is the most important decision in your life that you really took time to consider? For example, if you are just graduated from high school, perhaps the most important decision in your life is to what course would you take on college. And if you graduated from college, maybe you have to consider so many options, job options that you are going to do. And perhaps if you are going to build a business or build a house, those are the things that you really need to consider attentively, because you might experience regret, okay, if you continue to decide without considering all the options, without weighing all the things that needs to be done. But if you ask me this question, what is the most important thing that I consider, the most important decision that I took time to consider? There are a lot of things, but this is the most important decision that I took time to consider, is getting married to someone, a stranger. No, you don't know yet. By God's grace, God provided a way that I was able to meet her. And during that time, when the time is kanang okay na, if the right time comes, then I weigh a lot of options. After considering all the things that needs to be done before marrying her, and the same thing that happens to her, perhaps the more difficult in her side. But we have decided to bond together in the holy matrimony, and we embrace, because when you are united with someone, no, somebody advised us, marriage like a bird in a cage. You put the bird on the cage, but wala na exit. Nanagin na diha. So, buta sa butana that kanano, only death can separate the married couple. Only death can separate us. So I will be spending all my life with this woman. That's why marriage is one of the most important decisions that you really need to consider in life. And after marriage, now, how many children, no, that we want? Now, on her side, siya nga, Amira is okay. Pwede na usa. Ko, no, I want another one. So by God's grace, God has given us a child. And it's a boy, praise the Lord. And we never expected to happen because it was during pandemic. And that's one of the things that I was productive during pandemic. And thank God, no? And these are the things that we need to consider. How many children that we must, we plan to produce. So because raising a child is really difficult, no? And it is also expensive nowadays. So, but you know what? There is one thing that is far above that we need to consider. And this is the most important above all things that you are considering right now. And this is the ultimate one. We must consider Jesus. We must consider Jesus. Before you decide in your whatever your decision right now, maybe in family, in your career, in your business, not just considering the finances, that your situation, but you must have to consider Jesus above all. Because whatever your decision right now, perhaps it will also affect your relationship, your walk with Jesus as a Christian. So you have to consider Jesus in every area of your life. Now, this was written to Jewish people who are experiencing persecution, who are experiencing trials in life, and perhaps the preacher sensed that some of them are in the brink of quitting, in the brink of forsaking their faith and returning to their old ways of life, returning to Judaism. And perhaps the preacher tries to paint the picture. Before you do something, you have to consider Jesus first. You have to consider Him. You have to consider Him. So that's why he laid down the foundation why we need to consider Jesus. So there, now he started the word therefore. This is now the application of what he has discussed in the previous chapter, that Jesus Christ is our able help. He helped us. He was the one who gave us life and all the things that He discussed in previous chapter. Anyway, I will be discussing the previous chapter later, for a while. Now, Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1. Therefore, and notice that he addressed his audience, holy brothers and sisters, partakers of heavenly calling. Now, there are a lot of description to describe a Christian, a follower of Christ, but he specifically addressed them, holy brothers and sisters and partakers of heavenly calling, because this is actually connected to the previous chapter, in verse 10 and 11. Let me show you. Okay. Christians are described as holy brothers and sisters. Now, notice the word holy here in this verse is emphasizing our position in salvation. This is not, the preacher or the writer of this, the author of this book, he called Christians holy not because they are religious, not because of their works, but the word holy here is the position of their salvation. The one who made them holy is Christ. This is not credited to their own works. This is not credited to their own doing, but this is God's doing in their lives. God was the one, Jesus was the one who made them holy. So the holy here is they are set apart, for himself. They are saved by God for himself. They are made righteous in the eyes of God. They are forgiven. So that's why they are holy. Now, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 11. This is so connected. For both he, Jesus, who sanctifies those who are sanctified, are all from one Father. Now, notice, there are two things that we need to be considering here. Number one, sanctified, past tense. This is now referring to the holiness that we have experienced in Christ. Okay? This is an imputed holiness. This is the righteousness of Christ imputed unto us. And therefore, in the eyes of God, we are made holy. We are justified. God will no longer punish us. God will no longer condemn us because Christ has already paid the price of our sin on the cross. And therefore, we are now sanctified, past tense na. We have already received this. But Jesus will also sanctify us. So meaning, after we receive this sanctification or this holiness, this righteousness, Christ will also continuously sanctify us in becoming more like Jesus. Those who are called by God will become more like Christ. Okay, munang sanctification process. So we are now still in our state of sanctification while we are still here on earth. But in God's eyes, positionally, you are already holy in His sight. Now, secondly, verse 3a, partakers of heavenly calling. He called them holy and partakers of heavenly calling. Now, what kind of calling is this? Now, in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10, connected yapon siya, for it was fitting for Him, Jesus, for whom all things and through whom all things. So, notice that the writer or the preacher of this book established the fact that all things comes from God. Everything exists because of God. He is the one who created everything. Nothing comes to pass unless God made it happen. Now, he connects it now to salvation. Now, since all things comes from God, in bringing many to glory, He is now the one who brings individuals to glory. Meaning, since God is the author of everything, He is also the author of salvation. Everything comes from Him. Now, last 2 days ago, Amira said to my wife, and siya, "Mama, you're pregnant?" Siya, "Yeah, I'm pregnant." And then siya, I was amazed because she made this comment, "Because Jesus allowed you to be pregnant?" Kung kaning bataan knows already, okay, that life comes from God. Now, even our spiritual life comes from God. He calls us, He is the origin of our salvation. So, now, the Bible says that we are dead in our trespasses and sin. We are born, okay, dead on arrival spiritually, all of us. And it manifests the way we act, the way we do things, no? Just like a dead person, we are unresponsive to the stimulus, spiritual stimulus. That's why during our katong time that we are not yet born again, we don't have interest in God's truth. We don't love God's truth. We don't embrace the truth of God. We don't embrace Christ Himself because we love sin more than we love Christ. That's the evidence of a dead, spiritually dead person. And we have no ability to save ourselves because just like a dead person cannot raise himself, the spiritual dead person cannot save himself. Now that's why it needs the heavenly calling. It needs the call of God to bring that spiritual dead person alive. Why do you respond to faith in Christ? That's a mystery. Even me, it's a mystery. Why do I love Jesus? Because I know that this is the working of God's grace in my life. That's why those whom God has called, the other side of the coin is He also regenerates, meaning He made our spiritual life alive. And that's why we are able now to respond in faith and repentance. Because the originator of their salvation. The origin, ano na lang, Jesus is the origin of our salvation. Okay, so meaning the faith that you exercise to believe in Christ, the faith that you exercise to trust Christ, and to forsake sin is not yours. It comes from God. So therefore, salvation belongs to the Lord. So that's why all glory and honor belongs to Him. Now, another passage to prove my point. 1 Peter 2:9. "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of Him," notice again, "who called you out of darkness into wonderful light." Now, my friends, I tell you, you cannot go to the light unless God called you, unless God brought you, unless God draws you to Christ. You cannot go to Christ unless God the Father brought you to Christ. Why? First and foremost, you are His chosen people. So this effectual call, this eternal call or irresistible grace is only reserved for His chosen people. That's why if you are a Christian right now, if you truly believe in Christ and follow Him, all you need to do is to glorify Christ, honor Him, because God has shown you His great love. He has shown you the most wonderful thing that ever happened to a person. He made you alive. And there was a quote, no, from a theologian: "Jesus did not come to make bad people good. He comes to make dead people alive." So, muna siya. So the brothers and sisters in the faith are those effectually called by Christ to glory, made them holy and sanctifies them continually. So, not everyone is your brothers and sister. So, if you go to Kugon and you say to the Muslim, brother, he's not your brother. That's your neighbor. Ang imong tawagan na neighbor. Because only those who profess their faith in Christ, only those who are made holy, only those who are called by Christ are your brothers and sister. If you notice, when I'm here in church, I used to call David or even Jay, brother, Brad. Why? Because I meant that they are my brothers in Christ. Lani is my sister born, everyone here. Okay? Because they are followers of Christ. They believe in Christ. Okay? Now, karon, now the author of Hebrews made a foundation, yes. Now, he wants to give them the application. Therefore, is the conclusion. So, there must be an act. There must be an action that the author desires to see to his audience. And this is also the same for us. Now, the action word is consider. The apostle and high priest of our confession, Jesus. Consider. Now, the word consider is kataneo, means to direct one's whole mind to an object. Okay? Just imagine if you are, di ba, going to build a house. If you have decided to build a house, you have to consider, you have to direct your mind of that particular plan, weighing your money, the manpower, meaning you are going to fix your mind. You have to be focused because you are considering. You are weighing every options, okay? Because you want that house or building to be done. So you focus. Then word consider is to immerse oneself in it. This is not a joke. You are serious about it. You're going to work for it. You are so committed to it. You're going to do exactly what is planned. You immerse oneself in it. There's a commitment. And then, hints to apprehend its whole compass. So just like if you are a mountaineer, okay, going to a place that you don't know, one thing that you really need to consider every time is the compass, because compass will direct your goal where you want to go. So every time you need to consider, uy, asa na mo ni? West, east, north. Why? Because you are okay. You focus. You immerse your life because you want to experience or you want to achieve a certain goal in life. Now, consider him. Consider Jesus. Now, according to Hebrews, this is another verse. No? Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Again, the author of Hebrews is making an application. No? Later than that, but I give you an advance party. Consider him. Consider him. So that you will not grow weary and lose heart. So if you are weary now and you are losing heart, you are discouraged, you are fearful, you are in doubt, and you are almost giving up, my advice to you, consider Jesus. Consider Jesus. Now, what do we need to seriously consider about Jesus? This is the question that we need to be asking. Now, consider Jesus' calling, the apostle and high priest of our confession. Now, Jesus calling us apostle. The term apostle is derived from classical Greek, meaning one who is sent off, pinadala. Okay? Okay? Now, Jesus is the apostle because he was sent by God the Father to be his spokesman and revealer of God's will. Now, James, Apostle Peter, Paul, they are apostles of Christ because Christ sent them. They represent Christ. Christ sent by God to represent God himself. Okay? Because Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He's the Son of God. Okay? Now, that's why in Hebrews 1:2, in his last days, has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also made the world. God has spoken to us in his Son. Long ago, God spoke to us through the prophets, but now, he elevates. God now speaks to us through Jesus Christ. Okay? And that's why in John 6:29, Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, is to believe in the one he has sent." Because Jesus Christ is the apostle of God. How can you know for sure that he is the apostle of God? He's the one that is sent by God as the Messiah, as the one who would save his people. Of course, Christ does the will of God. He obeys all the law. He obeys all the requirements. He preaches the truth. And God made a stamp of approval to Jesus. Why? Because of the miracles that he performed. And Christ was risen from the dead. And therefore, it affirms, it solidifies that Christ is the one sent by God. He's the apostle. That's why we must seriously consider Jesus, because he is sent by God to speak to us in him. So, my friends, brothers and sisters in the Lord, there are many things that you are hearing all over, in radio, perhaps your negative thoughts, whatever thinking that you are thinking right now, do not listen to it. Listen to the one that God has sent. Believe in him. Do not look upon your fear and worries. Instead, place your trust in Christ alone, because he is the one sent by God. Now, another one. Consider the calling of Jesus as high priest. Now, the old covenant high priest offered gifts and sacrifices for sins on behalf of men in relation to God. Now, in Hebrews 2:17, it says, "Therefore, all things he had to be made like his brother, so that he might become merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, making propitiation for the sins of the people." So one of the main jobs of the high priest is to offer sacrifices acceptable to God, so that God would cleanse the people of their sin. And even the high priest will make himself clean before God through the blood, so that he can be worthy in coming to the presence of God. Now, Jesus Christ is our high priest. Why? He is the one who offered sacrifice, a perfect sacrifice that is acceptable to God, so that our sins will be forgiven, so that our sins will be erased, so that our sins will be removed. And he's not just a sacrifice, but he himself is the high priest. The high priest. So therefore, this truth alone is enough for us to continually follow Christ. Why? Because he's the one who made us righteous in the eyes of God. We are forgiven. That's why, from time to time, I need to be reminded of the gospel. I need to be reminded of the beautiful message of the gospel. Yes, I am a pastor. I'm preaching. I am leading Bible study and other things that I'm doing. But you know what? I am not resting on my works. for me to be justified in the eyes of God. I am resting upon the cross of Christ alone. Because there are times perhaps I might deceive myself, that I might be comfortable of what I have accomplished as a pastor, as a servant of God. And perhaps I might rest my trust on my works. But those are rubbish. Only the works of Christ can be accepted by God. That's why I rest my salvation, my righteousness on Christ alone. So that's why you do not deceive yourself. If you are trusting now of your accomplishment, if you are trusting now of your religious activities because your parents are Christians, do not be deceived. The only thing that can save you, that can make you justified in the eyes of God, that can make you holy, that can make you His child, is the one that is offered, the perfect sacrifice, Jesus Christ. That's why, di ba, I am always picturing myself, even today. One day, all of us will face God. All of us will face the righteous, holy, just God. And I know in myself that I am a sinner. The only confidence that I can face God is that I have Christ in my life. I have the righteousness of Christ. And this alone I claim. Because without Christ, I'm doomed to eternal hell. So, my friend, rest upon Christ alone. That's why 1 Timothy 2:5, there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, the one who reconciles us to God, the one who intercedes for us to God. We must consider Jesus as our high priest. He alone satisfies God's justice and mediates us to God. Now, consider Jesus' fidelity, His trustworthiness. He was faithful to Him who appointed Him as Moses was all in His house. Now, the author of Hebrews described this, that Christ was faithful. He was faithful high priest, he was faithful son, and he was faithful to his appointment. Who appointed him? God. Okay? And remember, the audience is Jew, Christian Jew. And Jew take high regard to Moses. They take high esteem to Moses, and they gave high accolades to Moses. But, okay, and he affirmed it, no? That Moses was also faithful. But Christ is more, will get more glory than Moses. Now, let us now begin to define what is Christ's faithfulness. Now, Christ's faithfulness is manifested in His total reliability, He can be trusted. Constancy, meaning He is consistent. He does not change His promises, in His doing, in His words. 100% guaranteed every time. He's perfect. And shown by His personal character and made known by His words and works. So this is the faithfulness of Christ. On every angle, in every area of Jesus' life, one conclusion can be made. Christ is faithful. He is faithful in everything He does. He is faithful in His promises. He is faithful in every way. Now, how faithful Jesus is. Now, Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of Him who sent me and to accomplish His work." This is how committed Jesus is. Even death cannot overcome Jesus. Trials, pain in life, He is so committed that even all those things, betrayal, suffering that He experienced in life, He was able to accomplish the work of God. Why? Because He's faithful. He's faithful. That's why in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, we can trust Christ. Christ is faithful. Christ is faithful yesterday. Now, if you are facing difficult times right now, if you're facing fear, worries in life about your family, about your future, about your business, I want you to consider this. Remember Christ yesterday. Remember what He did to you previously. How He has taken care of you. How He has provided all your needs. How He protected you. Remember those days. Because the faithfulness of Christ is shown to you yesterday. Today, Christ is still faithful. His faithfulness continues until today. The Christ that sustains you yesterday is the same Christ that will continue to sustain you today because He is faithful. He is faithful in your life. He's faithful. So rest upon Christ's faithfulness, not upon your works, not upon yourself or other people, and even forever. Christ's faithfulness continues forever. Why? Because Christ will not change. So rely upon the faithfulness of Christ. Now, even in our salvation relies upon the promises of Christ. Why? We believe the Word of God, and we embrace it, and that is true. And we believe that God is able to deliver what He said. That's why we cling upon the cross. We cling into the promises of God. Why? Because God can be trusted. That's why one of the verses that I really love is those who trust in the Lord will not regret it. Why? Because God is faithful. God is faithful. So Jesus is worthy of our earnest consideration, for He is faithful in every way. Do you believe that? Do you truly believe that? That God, Christ, is faithful in every way? Trust Him. Trust Him. He's faithful. He's faithful even in this pandemic ECQ. Christ is faithful. Now, again, consider the superiority of Jesus. Now, in verse 3, for He has been counted worthy more glory than Moses. By just so much as the builder of the house has more honor than the house. Now, notice this is a contrast, okay? Jesus is counted more glory than Moses. Why? Because the builder of the house has more honor than the house. So the builder of the house here is Jesus. And the house here is referring to Moses. Okay? God is the builder of everything. Jesus is the builder of everything. He's the source of everything. And Moses will not exist unless the builder of the house made him. So the house, okay, everything that exists comes from God. And even our life right now is sustained by God because He is the one who gives us the strength. Okay? So the builder of the house has more glory than the house. Okay? So, okay, I remember, no? When I'm passing the kanang Silver States ba? Dindutas balay eh. Okay? Yeah, maka-appreciate ka, no? Their house are big and magnificent. The structures, or even going to Singapore, wow, amazing. But one thing that really amazed me is, how man sila nagkuwag budget, anak, makatuko na lang. How man sila? And then, you find out, no nga, eh, he's the owner of this building. Wow. Grabe. Uwi ana. Di ba? This man is capable of building such things. So, the builder of the house has more glory than the house. Has more glory than the people, the his workers. Because He's the one who sustains. He's the one who provides for them. That's why in Matthew 16, verse 18, I also say to you that I will say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. Jesus Christ is speaking this. And the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will build my church. And this is referring to all believers. And the gates of hell cannot overcome the believers. How many trials, difficulties, even hell. Muna naman siya is exaggeration. Muna naman pinaka ngilngig. Hell cannot overcome believers. How much more COVID? How much more pain? How much more sickness cannot overcome? Because you are built by Christ. You are sustained by Christ. That's why, consider Jesus. Every house is built by someone else. Yan ang yung gift. Wala na yung tumpik-tumpik pa ang author. The builder of the house is God. So therefore, Jesus is God. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God has prepared in advance for us to do. God's handiwork, God's workmanship. We are created by God. Our faith originates from God. So consider Jesus' superiority. Okay? Now, nakita na ito kanina. Okay? But nga, Moses is servant and a house na karon, but Christ was faithful as a son over his house. Now, whose house? Kesa maning house, referring we are. So the house is a metaphor of a family. People belong to his family. The house, me and my house, referring to his children, family, relatives. Faithful as a son. Now, remember again that this is a Jewish context, Jewish people. So when the author says that Christ was faithful as a son, he is actually talking about Christ's authority, Christ's deity, and his being a Messiah. Okay? Jesus' sonship highlights his relationship to the Father, his messianic role, and divine nature. That's why when the Jew heard that Christ was ascribing God as his Father, nitingkag ang ilang dalungan, nitaas ang ilang kilay, nibukal ang ilang dugo, and they wanted to kill Jesus because for them, it's a blasphemy. Why? They wanted to kill him because he not only broke the Sabbath, but he also said that God was his Father. So their conclusion is making himself equal to God. Because he revealed to them that he is the Son of God. Hebrews spoke it very clearly. In his last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom appointed heir of all things, and through whom all he made the universe. Grabe, no? Now, this is now the description of the sonship of Christ. Okay? Perfectly stated, he is Christ, the radiance of his glory. So the glory that is worthy to God, the glory, the esteem, the praises that is that God can be received is the same glory that Jesus must receive. And Christ, the exact representation of his nature, so the very nature that God has is the same with Jesus. The essence, the power, and even the authority that God has, Jesus has. So therefore, Christ is the Son of God. That's why sa Luke 9:35, the voice came from the cloud saying, this is my Son My son, whom I have chosen, listen to him. We believe that Christ is Son of God. We believe that he is a Savior. The question is, I'm asking you right now, do you listen to him? Upon hearing this message right now, are you listening? Or you're doing something else? Ate ka nakita? Are you listening? Are you opening your spiritual ears? Paying attention to what I am saying right now because this is the Word of God. Listen to him. Na yung mga kanta, listen to your heart. No, listen to your heart. Ay, kalami pa may naon. Do not listen to your heart. The heart is the most deceitful above all. Listen to Christ. Do not listen even to your feelings. Do not listen to those things, to your fear. Listen. Pay attention. Consider him. Munang ganahan kay katong introduction ni Nolly De Castro. Hoy! Kising! Listen. Jesus deserves our thoughtful consideration. Why? He is the builder and sustainer of his church. If you are a house of God, a belong to his family, you have nothing to worry about. Why? He is the one who sustains you. Because he's the builder of the house. He's the one who sustains you, who supplies everything you need. Because Christ will finish what he started in your life. Now, what will be our response after all this earnest consideration? After hearing that Christ is the apostle of God, the high priest who offered himself as a perfect sacrifice so that we'll be forgiven, been made righteous, adopted into his family, after hearing that Christ is a faithful servant, he's faithful in every way, after hearing that Christ is the Son of God, after hearing all these things, what will be our response? Hebrews 3:6. If we hold firmly to the confidence and the boast of our hope. Now remember, okay, we are His house. We belong to God's house if we hold firmly to our confidence. Now, if is a condition. Now, you can be proven that you are really His house by your endurance. When you endure your Christian life in the midst of every suffering, trials, painful things that you experience in life, it proves that you are His house. Why? Because you are sustained by God. Our job is to persevere, but the preservation is God's job. You persevere because Christ preserves us. But if you quit, if you give up, if you say, I'm done with this, I'm going my own way, I return to my old ways, it's so painful, I'm gonna do the things that contrary to my faith, it only proves that you are not His house. So, consider Jesus. Consider Jesus. Think twice. Persevere. Persevere. Hebrews 10:23. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. Without wavering. We hold continually. Stand firm. Why? Because he who promised is faithful. Christ is faithful. He will sustain you. He will strengthen you. He will be with you. Our faith is anchored upon the promises of Christ and his character of being faithful. Philippians 1:6. I am confident, Paul says this, of this very thing, that he, Jesus, who began a good work among you, will complete it by the day of Christ Jesus. God, who began a good work among you, will complete by the day of Christ Jesus. He will complete. Yes, we are still living in this fallen world. We experience trials, but trials are God's tool for us to build us up, to strengthen us, to increase our faith, because He will complete the work He has begun in us. So Christian life should be a life of joy, a life of peace, a life of complete trust in Christ. Yes, we are human beings. There are things that we are struggling in life. But you have a choice right now, because God liberates your will. You have a choice to trust Christ. Rest upon Him. Rest upon Christ alone for your salvation. Consider Jesus seriously and put your hope in Him firmly, for He is faithful. He is faithful. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You so much for Your word this morning. We give You praise, Lord, for strengthening us, encouraging us, even in the midst of this strictest quarantine. But Lord, we are assured that You are faithful to provide. You are faithful to do what You have started in us and transforming us. Oh Lord, we surrender. We surrender everything unto You. In Jesus' name, amen.